The teenager who made national headlines.
For 2 days with no food or water, I make my journey to freedom knowing that I am following my God into the unknown.
By defying her father and following her faith.
My father confronted me and said exactly what he would do. He did say the words, "I will kill you."
Rivka Berry's story on today's 700 Club Interactive.
Good morning and welcome to the show. In many countries, leaving Islam and converting to another religion is punishable by death. So what happens if a Muslim living in America converts to Christianity? Rivka Berry knows. Growing up in an abusive home, by age 12, she was suicidal. Her search for meaning led her to Christ. But when her dad found out, Rivka's life was in real danger.
I grew up in a tiny island under India named Sri Lanka, and my family was extremely devout. I grew up breathing Islam. That was the way of life. It was in our DNA. There were two events that occurred as a child that changed everything. One was I was blinded by my brother accidentally through a toy airplane in my right eye. And the other was I was sexually violated by an extended family member. Normally, when things like that occur, the shame and the punishment is put on the abuser. But in my culture, the shame is put on the victim. I was seen as this half-blind picture of imperfection, and now I've ruined our family name. In order to run from that, we left Sri Lanka and moved to the United States. Moving to the United States was extremely difficult because there's the standard of, okay, you are now Muslim, thrust into a culture that is absolutely contradictory to everything you believe. I felt really suffocated because it was as if I was watching through a glass window, watching people enjoy these simple daily things like eating food or wearing pretty dresses that were modest, but I wasn't allowed to even think of those things. There was these questions that I felt that Islam couldn't answer. It took and it took and it took, but it never gave. And it simply commanded that I obey in fear of Allah. I remember thinking, if this is what life has to offer, I don't want it. My first taste of Christianity came when I was living in New York City and I met my neighbor, Emma. 9/11 had just occurred, and so our entire, you know, city is grieving. I hear Emma and she's just like, "Hey, you want to come over? We're praying." It didn't occur to my 9-year-old mind that they might be praying to a different God. So with a hint of curiosity, I just go innocently. The love that was in that room was overwhelming, but the minute I heard the name Jesus, I bolted out of that room in fear, knowing that I was strictly forbidden from any interaction with things that had to do with Christianity. And I felt so guilty that I had even been there, and just the fear of what if my parents could have found out. I lived in constant fear of my father. I was seen as an object, and so there were regular beatings. I am 12 years old, and I'm considering suicide. I said, "God, if you are real, show me who you are and I will follow you. If you're Allah, if you're Buddha, if you're Jesus, I just want truth. Please show me who you are." And I had no idea that he would actually answer. And months later, I met Angela, the brave young woman in my junior high class. And she approaches me and then she says, "Do you want to come to church with me?" And I walked into that church. I was terrified the entire time. I had all these clashing mental things, but yet my heart was feeling something that I couldn't push away. So I went forward in the altar call, and I didn't even reach the front of the altar. I was in the middle and just broke down, where I could, in the same moment, feel all my pain and brokenness being given to God and receiving His love and mercy and forgiveness. My life changed that day. After my conversion, I did go into a life of secrecy. I had 4 years where I hid my faith for my family, and I knew I wanted to fully give myself to Christ. But at the same time, I'm being forced to memorize page after page from the Quran to recite at our mosque gathering. It got to the point where I could not hide my faith anymore. My father confronted me and said exactly what he would do. He did say the words, "I will kill you." So my dad had left on a business trip after this confrontation. My mother approaches me and she says, "Our phone has been ringing off the hook. The mosque has been calling and saying either we take care of you or they will. which in my understanding is that I'm going to be killed. My father has now cut his trip short. My phone is cut off so that I have no access to anybody outside. I'm kind of held hostage at this point. God kindly brings individuals my way. One of them was Brian Williams, and he knew what was going on. Brian says, I know the perfect place for you. Let's take you to Florida, Beverly and Blake Lorenz. So we all kind of come up with a plan in order to escape my home. I hop on a bus, and for 2 days with no food or water, I make my journey to freedom, knowing that I am following my God into the unknown with the only promise that he will be with me. I had no idea what awaited me in Florida when I got there. You know, my plan was simply to stay there and hopefully just get off the radar and become 18 and be able to be free legally. But my parents had other plans. They were very intent on finding me. I actually ended up going to a juvenile detention center, which is jail, throughout that period for a few days. I had numerous foster homes that were not easy. I mean, it just seemed like I went from one abusive situation to another. On my 17th birthday, I had a court hearing where my story went national. The custody battle began.
This is not just some threat. This is reality.
On one hand, I was glad that we had the media like speaking out my behalf. That way nothing could be hidden. But at the same time, it was really unreal, just the ability that the press had to say whatever they wanted, and I couldn't interject. During that time span, the Lord in his kindness moved me to a wonderful home with two Christians who love the Lord with all their heart, who took care of me, who loved me, and to this day, I still call them Mama and Papa. When I was 18, the case closed because I aged out of the system. And in that moment, it was as if there were shackles just off my hands. And I remember just squealing, thinking, I am free. Like I had the freedom to worship and I could sing. I was so excited that I didn't have to hide anymore, that I could just open up the Bible. And I was so proud of it. You know, like, look what I have. God has redeemed my story, but there is still a real loss. I have not had any interaction with my family, and I think it's hard for people to understand that. But I love them. I think prayer has been a huge factor in me praying for my family and having compassion on them and grieving for them and hoping that they would find the same freedom that I have found. I want to give hope to people who live in my Islamic culture, who lived as I lived, that there is hope, that it doesn't have to be scary. Jesus showed himself to me in such a way, through his love, through his word, where my heart was lit ablaze. I look at what God has done in my life, and I'm so grateful. Even in the midst of such loss and grief, I have seen God work miraculously in my heart and giving me freedom and joy and love and peace. Despite all the loss and grief I feel, I have no regrets and I would do it again.
Rivka is so courageous. It's an inspiration. And it's hard not to note her courage there. And when we think of people that look at Christianity and come from a different faith tradition, whatever faith tradition that is, in her case, it was Islam, we see there that when there's an inquiry of what Christianity is, God will respond. And when I first saw this story, I thought of, in the Gospel of John, we read of Nicodemus, who was a Pharisee. He was on the religious council, the Sanhedrin. He was an expert in the Jewish law. If someone knew the faith tradition, it was Nicodemus. He went to Jesus Christ under the cover of night so he wouldn't be criticized. And he found Jesus and he said, look, we have noticed these miracles you've been performing. And some of us think you must be of God. It's not what we normally understand, but we think you must be of God just because of the miracles you're performing. And Jesus didn't say, thank you for noticing. He didn't say, because of this recognition, I will bless you. He didn't even show gratitude for the statement or inquiry. He said, you will never see the kingdom of God unless you are born again. And Nicodemus said, I don't understand this. This is not something I get. Born again? I've been born once. How can I be born twice? And we read of this conversation of a man who wanted to know what following Christ was all about. And Jesus took the conversation seriously and explained a lot of concepts. And Nicodemus, read about it, John chapter 3, Nicodemus didn't get it. So Jesus makes it simple to this educated man, this expert in the faith that he was taught, a brilliant scholar. He couldn't understand what Jesus was saying. So Jesus broke it down in simple terms. For God so loved the world that he sent his only Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish, but have eternal life. That's the context for that verse that even non-Christians know, John 3:16. It was in those tender moments with someone inquiring of Christ where Jesus laid that out. In the following verse, the news is almost as good. Jesus said, God did not send his Son to condemn the world, but to save it. Rivka prayed, reveal yourself, whoever you are, Lord, reveal yourself to me. And she almost seemed surprised. Jesus responded. Nicodemus sought out Christ. Who are you? What does it mean to follow you? And Jesus responded and gave us John 3:16, which Christians need to become familiar with again, because we spend so much time trying to earn our way to heaven, to please God, to outdo someone else in our devotion to the Lord. And Jesus desires us to believe in him, accept him, and reflect his love to a watching world. That's what we need to recall. And if you need prayer today, I want to encourage you to give us a call at 888-777-1999 and say, I want to know more about Jesus Christ, the one who has come to save the world. I want to go over to Jessica now. Jessica, good morning.
Good morning, Andrew. Those were great stories, and we have more to come. Coming up, they risked their lives for their faith.
Day by day, the situation had been more difficult, and it was a risk for me also.
Even if I say Jesus Christ, they may kill me.
My health, they try to kill me also. Then I start to run away.
We'll take you to a place where revival is breaking out within the Islamic Republic of Iran.
Revival is underway in one of the most unlikely places on earth, the Islamic Republic of Iran. Christians there are risking their safety and even their lives to worship Jesus. And as Chris Mitchell reports, many have fled to Turkey to escape persecution.
When someone gets baptized in this house church, people clap and cheer like fans at a World Cup match. While they've suffered persecution and often fled for their lives, they still possess an infectious and joyous faith like Rizal.
Growing up, I really want to say I grew up with Jesus Christ, because all the time his name was in my mind. And the next moment, I started liking Christianity. It was really sweet to me, the feeling, the stories, everything. So by the time I was 15, I believed in him and I said, I want to be a Christian.
Many Iranian Christians have fled Iran and come here to Turkey, where they can seek refugee status with the United Nations. Some say it's just like coming out of the darkness.
Totally different from here. I can privilege God's word to other guys. I can freely praise the Lord. I can easily go to church. It's really completely different.
Afshin attended the church led by American pastor Saeed Abedini, who was imprisoned in Iran for his Christian faith. After Abedini's arrest, the church disbanded. Later, Afshin found himself on the run.
As a result, I came out of Iran because day by day the situation had been more difficult, and it was a risk for me also. I had to even change our home because I was sure that one day they will realize our home as an underground, as a house church. They will recognize it. The intelligence service will recognize it.
Others fled for their lives, like Reza and Razal, his sister.
So it was really hard situation for me to go there. I couldn't even pray God with all my heart because I know all trouble was there. Even if I say Jesus Christ, they may kill me.
It become problem for my job. And my health, they try to kill me also. Then I start to run away.
Despite the constant threat, danger and risk, these believers keep the faith. Now they find a church home and family. Their pastor leads house churches in Iran, as well as the US, Canada, Germany, and Malaysia, all via Skype.
The main church is my house, and through the internet, I connect to everybody. That's why it's become like an internet church.
He says a great revival is underway within the Islamic Republic of Iran.
Right now, you can see the results of the Holy Spirit. From 1994, there were about 100,000 believers. Right now, there are 3 million. You can see what the Holy Spirit is doing with the people.
Many became Christians through a dream or vision.
I had a dream long time back. I mean, every time that Jesus was with me. And in all of my life, he was helping me. And I didn't know who is this person. Suddenly, Jesus Christ was over there. And he said, come to me. Then I come to that side, and he accepted me.
Despite all the hardship and being forced from their homeland, these believers exude joy. Many hope to one day achieve refugee status and immigrate to other countries. In the meantime, they want believers in the West to pray for the church in Iran.
And I'm just begging really from the other believers, from the other sisters and brothers from all over the world to pray for Iran, to all the people of Iran to be familiar with God, with Jesus Christ.
Chris Mitchell, CBN News, Central Turkey.
Thanks so much, Chris. You know, we hear so many reports about how the Spirit of God moves to people in that area of the world through dreams and visions, and that the Holy Spirit wakes them up in the middle of the night with dreams about Jesus Christ. You know, it's important for us to remember in a time when we hear so much news out of Iran and things that really outrage a lot of Americans, to remember there are many people living there that love Jesus Christ desperately, even love America, and we need to keep them in prayer. And Jessica's story like that really reminds us of that.
Absolutely, Andrew. You know, it's been said that persecution is the seedbed of the church, and we see that here in Iran, and we've seen that throughout history, from as early as the Roman Empire to more modern examples like the underground church in China. And it produces such a passion in spite of their persecution.
And sometimes we're so comfortable in this country, and then when things become uncomfortable for us, we feel persecuted. Stories like that are a real reminder of what people face around the globe.
Well, they're absolutely inspiring.
Yeah. Well, coming up, she has a powerful TV ministry throughout the Middle East, but that wasn't always the case.
I remember being beaten up, kicked on the floors. I believed I was stupid. I believed I was ugly. I felt very filthy, and I felt like it was my fault.
The dramatic encounter that turned this abused woman into a powerhouse. That's after this.
Abuse followed Ishak Abla from childhood to marriage. By age 28, she was twice divorced and failing miserably as a mom. So Ishak planned a permanent escape from her problems, suicide.
When I was 4 or 5 years old, I had a dream about Jesus. And he said, don't be afraid of death. You are going to have an eternal life. Ben Ishak Abla, bu benim hikayem. My father was a womanizer, and my mother used to have nervous breakdowns. Every time she found out about his affairs, she used to just fall apart. And every time they had a fight, slamming the doors, cursing each other, I used to hide. And then when they used to see me, they used to tell me, it's all your fault. I wish you have never been born. I remember being beaten up, kicked on the floors. I believed I was stupid. I believed I was ugly. I felt very filthy, and I felt like it was my fault. I studied a lot. I read everything I could find. I started learning Quran from my great-grandmother and tried to learn and be a good Muslim. I thought it was fascinating that there was a being who created me. And if I knew him, and if I find him, he could change my misery. I knew that I needed a miracle, but I had no relationship with my God. I prayed 5 times a day. I never heard back from him. So I came to a conclusion, there was God, there was a creator, but he was mean and hateful and always angry. I met this guy at college. He was a fanatical Muslim. I really believed he loved me. We got married. He started beating me up all the time, every other day. He used to kick me, spit on me, slap me in public, pull my hair. And I used to always find a fault in me. But then I started finding a relief at workplace. People started telling me I was smart. And I started climbing career ladders in Turkey. The more I became powerful at workplace, the more he abused me to keep me oppressed. One night, he put a knife on my throat and he told me to jump from the 8th floor of a building. I knew that even in the Quran, he didn't have a right to kill me. I decided I'm going to leave. I wanted freedom. I thought America is a free country. I want freedom. I got my divorce degree Friday and I graduated from my post studies in business administration Saturday and I fled to America on Sunday. But it didn't change. It doesn't matter. Wherever you go, you take you with you. And I took abused, hurt, insecure, angry, hateful, miserable woman with me to America. I said, I need a husband to tell me what to do with my life. And this time I met a drug abuser. And we had a child. Another type of depression and misery started. This was not physical abuse, but verbal abuse. And I decided to leave him. I was 28 years old, divorced twice, single mother, failed in every areas of my life. I became, that time, suicidal. I was working at a Christian company, and I had a Christian boss. He was really in love with Jesus. It was hard to understand how someone could be in love so much with his God. I didn't want to be a Christian. We called Christians infidels. They worship three gods. They called Jesus the prophet, son of God, blasphemy. So now I am more miserable because I see people, they have peace in their lives and they talk to their God. Their God talks to them. And I said, life is not worth living. I am not good for this life and God hates me. And I decided to end my life that day. I went to work. And I went to the restroom, I started having a disclosure with God. And I started telling, why do you hate me? What have I done so bad to deserve this? I knock on the counter and I said, here I am, I'm knocking at your door. Are you going to open the door? And I cleaned my face, I went back to my office. Then my boss called me. He said, please close the door and have a seat. And he said to me, I know this is going to sound very weird to you, but I have to be obedient. My Lord Jesus just spoke to me and he told me about what you are planning and he wants me to tell you. You are not forsaken or abandoned. When you were abused, Jesus was by your side. He loves you so much that he wants to be the center of your life. I went on my face to the floor and I started weeping bitterly and I said, yes, yes, Jesus. One single yes brought me to Jesus Christ. I felt freedom first time in my life. The freedom that I dreamed all my life was real. God always tells me, you are a new creation. You are crucified. It is all gone. Only I live in you. Only this moment and the future I prepared for you is important. I can thank him for who I am right now and who I am going to be. Ben Işık abla, iyileştim, şifamı aldım ve özgürüm.
Well, maybe you're watching today and like Işık and like Rifka Berry, you feel a tug on your heart to trust Jesus with your life. Well, we're going to pray today. And if you have any doubts or any concerns, put those aside. Let your heart be moved by God's presence. Today is a day for you for salvation. Join with us in prayer. Heavenly Father, we just lift up those who are watching the program today. And I just sense there are some of you who are saying, but God, I'm not brave enough. But God, what if I experience persecution? Maybe not in big ways, but maybe in small ways. The Lord wants you to know that he promises that through it all, his presence and his love will be with you. Today, give your heart to Jesus, and he will never leave you. He will never forsake you. You are loved and he wants to accept you right here, right now, right where you are. In Jesus' name, amen. Andrew?
Jessica, thank you. Beautiful prayer. We leave you today with these words from Jesus. They're found in the 14th chapter of John. Jesus answered, "I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me." For Jessica, I'm Andrew Knox, and we will see you next time on 700 Club Interactive. Bye-bye.